I may go about telling or trying to pretend that now I'm very happy because I got revenge and I got justice. But deep down inside, if you ask me, I'm still feeling miserable. There's an old Chinese proverb which says, before you set out to take revenge, dig two graves. You're going to kill the other person, not to take revenge. But you're killing yourself, sort of. Is it working?
Yes.
Hi, good morning. You go virtual, okay? And the other aspect is how I lose out, you know, when I become angry or bitter or whatever it is. Supposing, I'm working hard in some organization or something of that sort. And at some point, I was expecting a promotion. I don't get that promotion. And my junior was not as efficient as me and things of that sort comes. He goes and butters up the boss and he gets the promotion which should have rightfully been mine. Now I am very angry with both my boss and this colleague who went and buttered him up, and therefore he got the promotion, not based on merit but because of the chamchagiri that he did. Okay, fine. Now when I get angry and I say that, you know, how does it matter to the boss, whatever, whoever works hard, it doesn't matter and all that, my efficiency goes down. I'm no longer motivated to work. Bosses will come and go, somebody else will get promoted or something. At one point of time, I may even get fed up and leave that job. No, I'm fed up of these people, I don't like these people and this, and I'm very angry with them. I cannot forgive this boss, even though this was a good company, good salary, everything was there. I'm getting out, I'll go somewhere else. What happens is that my track record has come down. When they check up what was my performance, they will find that this fellow's track record had gone down. Why? Because I had lost my motivation, no? So I wasn't working as hard as I could have. I was not coming up to my own potential. And the other people also will not, you know, give me what is my due. Now this boss is not affected, the guy who overtook me is not affected. Finally, the person who is affected is myself. There have been innumerable times when I've sat down with somebody and said, okay, I'm no judge for you, you know, you decide what is right and wrong. But think of this, you said that last year you were denied this promotion, that's why you got so angry. And then you said, no, I'm just do my work and go, it doesn't matter to me, something, whatever you did. Who is the loser finally in the long run? Your organization is so huge that one person, you know, performing 30% less efficiency doesn't make any difference. Your boss has so many people working with him, he'll get his work done somewhere or whatever it is, it doesn't make a difference to him. So finally the person who's going to suffer is going to be you. And that brings me to the important point, that is, that forgiveness, as I said, is not for moksha or salvation. Forgiveness is not, you know, an act of charity that you are doing to the other person. Forgiveness is an act of self-love. If you love yourself, which is the topic of our Manthan camp also. This time I thought, you know, I really want to shake up people and think, because many of us really don't love ourselves. We spend too much time loving others, but we forget that there's one more human being with whom we live 24/7 and who also deserves our love. Basically being a good human being. And yet, we don't do enough to love ourselves. Now, forgiveness is part of that self-love. If I really value myself, and if I love myself, and if I feel that, you know, I'm basically a good person. I may not be a great person, I'm not a guru, swami, or some great person. I'm an average human being, I've never hurt anybody consciously, I don't put down people, all those things. So I also deserve to be happy. Now what happens, you know, is, supposing X did something bad to me. At that time, let's say I had no control. He was my boss, or he was somebody who I trusted and I thought he would give the money, but he, you know, turned out to be a cheat. Whatever it is, or somebody with whom I had a close relationship and I invested in that relationship, and that person somehow turned out to be very nasty to me, or whatever it is. Now, when that has already, you know, happened, what happened to me and what hurt me and what disturbed me, I had no control over it. So the first step before we even talk about forgiveness is to ensure that I first resolve whatever is going through. So that person has cheated me and gone, okay, close that chapter mentally, emotionally. Or leave that job and go somewhere else. Or work out the relationship with this person so that either you leave that person or you insulate yourself against that person so that that person can't keep hurting you and all that. Once I've done that, then comes the question of forgiveness. That's something very important. Now, if somebody is hurting me badly, and the process is going on, and I forgive him, tomorrow he hurts me again. Again I forgive him, third day he hurts me. Now my anger and my irritation inside is actually increasing. See, three times I forgave him, and he is doing it again. So this is not the time to forgive. That is what we miss out. This is the time to first resolve how I am going to overcome my relationship, or how to protect my money, or how to protect my emotions, or whatever. It is first I have to do that. Otherwise, as long as I am vulnerable, there is no question of forgiveness. Because the other person can continue to take advantage of me. So first I resolve that. Now what happens is, I no longer give power to that person to, you know, hurt me. I have insulated myself, or I have now protected myself. By not forgiving, I am hurting myself. By going on thinking about that person, now I am creating that unpleasantness. That person is gone from my life, or at least he's there, but he's no longer in a position to hurt me because I've now done whatever I could to mentally and emotionally protect myself. So now that that has been taken over, I should lead a happy life now. But I keep going back into the past. I keep thinking, you know, what did he do to me? He did that. How could he do this? And that is one. Second equally important thing is, it affects my other relationships. Haven't you come across, you know, people who say, you know, never trust relatives. At least friends are good, but relatives are always horrible. Why? Because I had one or two or three relatives who were very bad to me. So I put everybody in a blanket. Now I may be having two, three other relatives who are actually willing to have a good, healthy relationship with me, but I don't let them come anywhere close to me. Because I put them all in that bracket of relative. You know, in my office, I don't trust anybody. I've been cheated so badly by X, Y, you know, in the office. Now I just go there, do my work and come off. What is happening because of that? Whenever I'm interacting with relatives, or whenever I'm going to office, I am sad, I am feeling that unpleasantness. Am I making any difference to that group of relatives or my colleagues in office? No. If there are 50 people working there and I decide not to be nice to people, the other 49 will be very happy. Not only that, they will all gang up against me. The moment they realize that I am not being friendly and I am not being open with them, they will form a sort of group or gang, whatever it is. And they will go against me. And then I'll get even more angry. See, I was right. These people don't treat me. They're all laughing, joking. They're all within one group. They're not including me in that. That is one part of it. Equally important is the other side of it. I keep telling people that whenever some Washington, Dillington in America or Europe or somebody comes up with a proverb, we immediately start writing down, you know, we tell children this proverb, quotes, this, that, and all over the place, we keep repeating all those things. And many of them, if you were to just sit and think for 5 minutes, you will realize that not only they are not applicable, they are downright stupid. One of the classic ones, which is so popular, and people keep repeating it to each other, forgive and forget. Forgiveness is within you. You can make efforts, you can put in that thing, you can change your attitude and you can forgive. Forgive and forget. Okay, I have forgotten that you hit me. I have forgotten that you cheat me. I have forgotten that you hurt me. I have forgotten this. I go on repeating that as a mantra. Forgetting is not in my control. And the more you make efforts to forget something, the more you talk about it. It's like that old proverb which says, you know, that most probably the atheists will be the first people to go to heaven. Because they go on saying, there is no God, there is no God, there is no God. So they take the name of God more than, you know, the normal average people. So it is something like that, you know, that you are all the time saying, I want to forget this. Firstly, it is not possible. I don't know who came out with this proverb, but I do know that a million people keep forwarding that thing and telling everybody. Okay. The second and equally important thing is, if you really want to have a good quality of life, I would say, forgive, but do not forget for the rest of your life. I have been cheated. Why? I trusted somebody. I felt that this fellow seems to be a very sweet chap and this and that, you know, he's in a bad situation, he wants a loan, whatever it is, I've gone ahead and done it. Now this fellow cheated me, right? And I came to know that he's a downright cheat. And he purposely came and tricked me and this and that and gave me all that sob story which was false. And therefore, you know, I got cheated. Now, even if I make efforts and forget that, what happens? Next time somebody else comes with a sob story. I've forgotten that I've been cheated, no? So I should remember that just because somebody comes and says that, you know, I'm in a desperate position and this and that, I should not believe people so easily. My money is also hard-earned money or something. Or I befriend somebody and I realize that that person is not reciprocating the friendship or the relationships. I should be very cautious. Last time when I went all out and trusted this person and was so nice and invested my time and emotions in this person, and then it turned out that this person was not reciprocating at all, and then I felt very hurt and upset, and all that trauma I went through, it took me a long time to heal myself. Now that I've healed myself, if I forget, it's just a matter of time when somebody else will walk in and do the same or similar thing too. So that's why I'm saying that you want to follow that type of karma, which should have been forgive, but do not forget. Okay. Now, one very simple thing is that, you know, how do you know that you have forgiven? People ask me this. Yeah, sometimes I think I have forgiven, sometimes I think that I have not forgiven. What does it happen? It is very simple. When I'm counseling somebody also, when I'm talking to them, the person says that, see, I had a very bad experience. My own relative did this to me, or my best friend did that to me, or in business or somewhere I had this very bad experience and all that, and that person is explaining to me. Inevitably, the first time that the person is talking, there's a lot of emotion coming out. How much I trusted that person, really angry with that person, so it comes out like that. As I always say in counseling, even if the person is repetitive, please don't stop him. Don't say, yeah, you already told me about that incident. Why? Because second time, third time, fourth time, when the person comes out with it, his emotions start coming down. So encourage the person to talk. Even if the person is repeating exactly what he had told you last week, again, allow the person to talk. If finally the person comes to a point where he or she can talk about it without getting emotional, where the person is recounting, saying that, yeah, I really think that, you know, I was a fool. I don't know why I trusted this person. Actually, I had some indicators that this person is unreliable. He had shown some behavior issues which should have been a caution to me. But I don't know, I'm that type, you know, keeps trusting people. And basically, I liked or loved that person, so I felt that I should be nice. Things will work out and all that. But then finally, this is the result that came out. So when you can talk about it in that tone, you know that you have achieved. If not 100%, at least some level of forgiveness. The opposite of that will happen again with some people, you know. If you say that you had mentioned that so-and-so had, you know, breached your trust, or so-and-so had cheated you, Would you like to talk about it? No, I don't want to talk about it. It's over and done with. Stupid fellow, this. I don't want to talk about it. I have forgiven, I have forgotten. I don't even want to recount that. What is that an indicator of? Come out. I don't want to talk about it. I don't want to talk about it. No, sir, don't ask me. Stupid fellow, I don't even want to mention that. It means it's bottled up so deep inside that even talking about it to you brings out so many emotions. So there is the question of forgiveness if it primarily boils down to emotion, no. So if those emotions are still so strong, then obviously I'm not forgiven myself. I start with that. And then I tell the person also, fine, you say that it is over and done with, I have forgiven, forgotten, I don't want to talk about it. Why is it? We just spend 10 minutes and you just narrate what happened to me. You said you have forgiven, forgotten, you said that now you have moved on, you have nothing to do with that person. Come, let's talk about it like how, yeah, I saw a movie in which there was this murder or crime or something. Yeah, I saw that, at that time I got a little shaken up seeing all that violence and all that. It's okay, I came out and then I said, okay, it's a movie. So you can talk about it. If I ask you what is that movie, this is what happened, there were so many murders and they kept killing people or something, I can recount that because it's not affecting me. These are some very important things that we have. Okay, before I start off with the tips and techniques, how you actually go through the process of forgiveness, one thing which you should not do is that when somebody is hurting you or cheating you or whatever it is, going on acknowledging and tolerating it with the hope that if you are nice to the person will change. This is a basic human behavior. I don't know why. Over ages, we have not learned that lesson. The more we keep tolerating the person, the more it gets reinforced to him that what I'm doing is right. It is something like the difference between a dog and a cat. You have a stray dog on the road. You call him, you feed him, you pet him, or whatever, you do something nice to him, and he becomes so loyal to you, and he sees that you're being so loving and caring, and he looks up at you and he says, you must be God. That is why you are doing so much for me. You take a cat and you feed her and look after her and do everything for her. And she gets all the comforts. And she looks at you and says, you're doing so much for me. I must be God. It's exactly the same thing happens. When you are being so nice to me, then what I'm doing must be right, no? Otherwise, by now, you should have been fighting me. You should have been dominating back at me, being violent at me, or whatever. It is, you're not doing anything of that sort. You're still being so nice and kind to me, so I must be God. I must be doing everything right. I don't want to change. This is a very basic and important thing. So then comes, this is very often, people come and say, why should I forgive? When he has been so bad, why should I forgive him? He did all this nasty thing, and I go and say, okay, I've forgiven you, it's all right, and all that. And that fellow will feel great. There's a very basic difference I want you to understand between forgiving in your mind and going and expressing your forgiveness to the other person. The second part of it, you should be very careful. If I feel that somebody has purposely, hurt me or cheated me or whatever it is, I forgive for myself, for my peace of mind, for me to push out that person and move on in life. But I don't have to go and tell him that I have forgiven him. Remember that. That comes only if you feel that it will be beneficial, that person will acknowledge and that person will feel. If you have that level of confidence, then you go and tell him that, okay, whatever has happened, I have forgiven you, let's move on. Many occasions, you tell that person and the person says, who are you to forgive me? I'm the one who should be forgiving you for all your nasty things. Finish, you're back to square one. So don't presume that forgiveness means going and saying, okay, I have forgiven you or something of that sort. Forgiveness is within you. For the rest of your life, that you need not tell that person that I have forgiven you. You need not meet that person if it is possible to take him away from your life. Or you continue to meet that person, interact with that person, but you know, you don't express that you have forgiven them, that you want to be nice to the person, things of that. Then one more very important thing in this is, when I feel that I have been hurt, I have been cheated or something, and I make up my mind that this person was very horrible and this person is the one who is the culprit and all that, always remember that in human relationship, it is never 100% and 0%. If this person has been nasty to me, it may have been 90% his fault, but there will be 10% of my involvement in the process. So first, let me work on that. Because I may not have very close interaction with this person now that he has hurt me or this thing. I'm going to insulate myself. I'm not going to have that type of loving, caring relationship which I had earlier with this person. So I'm insulating myself. But I'm still going to be living with myself for the rest of my life. That's again part of what I've told you about the mantra camp, that, you know, do I really love myself sufficiently to forgive myself also when I do something bad? That part I'm not dealing with now. But the fact remains that, you know, do I realize that I need to work on this thing of ensuring that I am moving out of that thing by first evaluating what has been my contribution to it and therefore setting myself right. One of the simplest ways of this is what I told you just now, tolerating somebody's you know, bad habits or bad behavior or whatever it is. Even that is a contribution from my side. That same person is not nasty with somebody else. Because he tries to be nasty, that person gives back. Shut up, you can't talk to me like that. No, sorry. But if that person comes to me and I say, oh, did I do wrong, these, and the person feels, yeah, finally I found one bakra, I can go on doing whatever I want with this person. So that has been my contribution, right? Do not, you know, ignore what has been your contribution, not from the point of view of forgiving this person, but from the point of view of preventing myself from getting into another bad relationship or being cheated by somebody or something in future. Life is very long. You know, you don't know the type of changes in relationships, what are going to come in your life, how things are going to be. We can never predict how things are going to change. And if at all you had become very complacent that life is going to be very smooth and this and that, I'm sure Madam Corona has taught you a lesson that don't expect that life will be the same as it was. So we always used to talk about before Christ and after denomination, BC and AD. So now it is before Corona and after Corona. So remember that also. And just to digress for a minute, I am very, very convinced that the after effects of Corona will start once everybody is vaccinated and the threat of the virus is gone. Many of us neglect history. But history teaches us so many lessons. Take a simple thing like, you know, the Second World War. When the Second World War came and millions of people had to leave their family and go and fight somewhere in Africa, Europe, Germany, wherever it is. They were such a nice, loving family and they were so distressed that my husband or my father or my son has gone away and is facing so much danger. Apparently, the emotional bond became stronger and stronger. They were desperately waiting, they were praying, they were hoping that nothing happens to him, he comes back safely. Years later, he came back with a lot of medals and promotions and this and that, and was disbanded from the military. The rate of divorce in USA shot up 3 times. Just after the people came back. So since he has come, tell me why that happened.
PTSD.
Why should that lead to divorce?
They became more aggressive because of the as you think that you have seen?
No, that is only one part of it. Not everybody becomes aggressive in PTSD. In fact, a lot of people withdraw into shells. Loneliness, so when you are lonely, because your beloved is out, then when the beloved comes back, you should feel such a strong emotion. No, see, I missed him for 2 years, 4 years, he was away. And now he has come back. I'm willing to do anything and everything for him. And same way, the man should say that, you know, I was away from my wife, my family, my children. Now I'm willing to go all out to be nice to them.
Emotional attachment.
Emotional attachment became stronger in the absence. Absence makes the, what is that?
They couldn't tolerate each other's
the way they were living. So many changes had come in each other. A simple thing like, you know, the wife used to depend on the husband for repairing that water pump or getting some electronic thing done or going out in the night and buying medicine or something. Years and years she was alone and she had become the man of the house and she could do everything. When this man came back, he realized he did not need it. My wife can run the household absolutely without me. There my whole battalion needed me. I was this macho leader and commandant and this and that. Here my own wife and children don't. And vice versa. She had got so used to running the house, being there, her own timing, when I want to eat, when I want to watch TV. Now anything that I have to do, this guy is hanging around her, changing the channel or saying I want this food or I want that. She had got so used to it. But anyway, that was one of the factors. The other factor was that they were found to be misfits in civilian society. They had got so used to the military style of working and this and that. That when they tried to impose the same rules and regulations in the private organizations where they were working, it didn't work. So that led to a lot of frustration. So normally you would think that the depression, the frustration and all that should happen when the war is going on and when there is a threat. It doesn't happen. You will see that also when, you know, a simple thing like if there is somebody in the family who is terminally ill. Now you are directly facing death. Doctors have said that there isn't much chance that this person will survive, this person is in pain, this, you know, their health is going worse day by day and all that. But most of the time we don't go into depression at that time. We actually rise up to the occasion. I will do anything and everything. I will try this. I will look after all the comforts. If allopathy doesn't work, I will get some Ayurvedic medicine and give, or I will go and pray to God and Tripathi, or I will do. We keep on rising to the top. When the person is gone, then you start sliding down. All the stress of that months and years of pain and this and that that you went through. So the same thing happens over here. I want you to understand that, like I told you about post-corona, people, when they get back to normal routine and then they realize that, you know, okay, no more restrictions. Children can go to school, we can go to office, we can go out and mingle with people freely and all that. That is when we realize the impact of this thing, how relationships have been. I know of people who have not met their elderly parents in the same city for months. So I don't want to pass corona to my parent. They are very young. Daddy's birthday, I will order a cake for him through Swiggy, and my children will put balloons in my house, and then we will have a video call and something, something, or those type of things. But that's not basic human thing. So tomorrow, when I'm actually back to normal, I'm interacting, I feel like a stranger with that person. So same thing happens over here, that when you have, when that, you know, the thing is over, okay, now that issue is over and this and that, now I'm protecting myself. So I know that I'm not no longer going to be hurt by this person. It is then that these things hit you. That is one thing which I want to caution you. Okay, with that, let us talk now about how do you actually do that. As I told you, the this thing has to be done within yourself. Did they show you that booklet on forgiveness?
Sure.
I got a small workbook type of thing, you know, on forgiveness. If anyone wants, you can keep it with you, either for yourself or to help anybody else. It's a ready, reckoner type of thing, but I think. So a few tips which I'm talking about now, most of it is there in that. You know, as I told you, first decide, I am going to forgive in my mind. It's got nothing to do with this person. It is, if it was Mr. X, it could have been Mr. Y, Miss Z, it could be anybody. That person is not important to me, I am important. So whatever I am going to do is going to be within my mind. I am going to come to that level of acceptance. Instead of tolerance, I will come to the level of acceptance. I will be at peace of mind, and then I will decide if at all I want to go and build relationship back with him. Or I may decide that no, I will keep this person either physically or at least mentally away from me for the rest of my life or till I change my mind or something. So you start working on this within your own mind. If you have some trusted person or counselor or somebody who can help you, well and good, it helps to bounce it off with somebody. But it's not 100% necessary, you can do it by, you know, yourself. Start with understanding that except for this minor contribution of mine, the major reason why I am hurt is because of your behavior. It is you who has done it. However much the other person may try to convince you otherwise, because there are oppressors who convince you that you are the one who did wrong. Because you did that, that is why I did this, that sort of thing. It is so common. I was the A class trustee of Alcoholics Anonymous for 6 years. Inevitably, so many confessed that they always looked for excuse. So a chronic alcoholic who would lose control over himself would tell his wife, "You nag me, that is why I drink. My boss is horrible to me, that's why I drink. My child is not getting good marks, that's why I drink. I'm very sad, therefore I drink. I'm very happy, therefore I drink." You get me? So that is what I will calmly, I can even sit and review what all happened. Why today I am feeling hurt. This is the incident. It started with this, then it was minor, then it grew. Then I tried to rectify, nothing happened, it increased and this and that. So, except for this minor contribution from my side, whatever it was, the major contribution was that. And I am not responsible for what you did. So don't tell me that, you know, I was nagging you, therefore you became an alcoholic. No, you're just trying to pass the buck to me. And whatever may have been your reason, you wanted to drink, you wanted to cheat money, you wanted to do whatever it is, I did not deserve that negative thing. I have not done anything to hurt you or cheat you or something. So I do not deserve to have this thing. There is no justification. If you're trying to give me that justification, sorry. Logically, it doesn't hold good. If I still have a doubt, I'll go to some neutral person, not even say that it is mine. Just say that there are two people, A and B. If A does this to B, is A justified in doing it? And a rational person will reinforce to me that no, A is not justified in it. So therefore, I'm sure that you're not justified in this thing. And I am not willing to be subjected to this now. So you can't keep doing this to me. It is not okay and it has been very painful. I will describe my own emotions. How I lost my night's sleep, how I was crying so much, how bitter I became, or how negative I am, or how I'm not being able to enjoy life, all the effect that it has had on me, starting with my emotions, going on to how it is affecting my life. So if I do this exercise over and over and over, not one day, keep adding to it, keep putting it, this whole pattern forms. Now I know clearly where I stand. And then starts the process of healing, which goes by. I do not want to spend the rest of my life trying to punish you. I've got better things to do. I don't want to take revenge. It's time consuming. It takes a toll on my emotions. You're not worth it. So I would rather spend my time emotionally connecting to people who are good to me, not to people like you. Even though you are a good person, this is another wonderful thing that I find from every GIW whom I meet. But he's a very good human being. He's a very good human being. I'm yet to come across any husband who is not a very good human being. Only he gets drunk. Only thing he does is, he is, does womanizing. Only thing he does is that he beats up people. But he's a very good human. Let's break that. It's not that we are putting down somebody, it's not that we are labeling. But there are, you know, habits or whatever it is, which are negative and which are not tolerable to me. I can't stop you from going and oppressing others, but I can definitely prevent it for you from, you know, hurting me in this sort of thing. I may still not withhold my love for you. This is also something which I can speak for hours on. There's a world's difference between liking and loving a person. You can like a person and not love him. You can love a person and not like him. So sometimes when you're in a very close relationship, you tend to love that person. But when you evaluate his habits, his characteristics, his, you know, behavior, you cannot like it. I cannot like somebody who hits. I cannot like somebody, you know, who cheats people. I cannot like somebody who uses bad language. I'm very clear on that. But I still love that person. So this is a very important aspect of the forgiveness. I don't mind, I'll still love you. But I'm not going to force myself to like you. There's a subtle difference, but it makes a difference. Why do I love you? Maybe because I have a relationship with you. It may be a blood relationship or a marriage relationship or whatever it may be. So I'm the type of person, I can't keep changing relationships and or switching off from relationships. So once I invest myself with that love, I will continue to love you. But that does not mean that I'm going to like you. I'm not going to, you know, try to protect you or try to camouflage the bad thing that you are doing. Again, the same thing, I'm giving the example of alcoholics. There are innumerable women who try to protect the husband who is drunk. Somebody suddenly turns up in the night and this fellow is in a horrible condition. She will push him into the bedroom, close the door and say, no, he had a headache, he went to sleep early today. Let the people, and they're close people, let's say her own parents or somebody, you know, close people, let them know what is wrong. No. You know, if they find out that he gets drunk and he misbehaves, it is an insult to me because he is my husband, that sort of thing. It is not. Always remember that you are first an individual and then somebody's daughter, wife, son, brother, whatever relationship you share with others. Do not give up your identity for the sake of a role that you are playing in life. Being somebody's wife or brother or mother or daughter is secondary to your own identity. It will take me time to rebuild trust. If it happens over a period of time, let us see. But right now, I'm going to protect myself and I'm not going to trust you and not allow you to do whatever is the thing. And I am responsible for how I feel. So I want to be loved in a particular way. I'm not getting that type of love or treatment that I want from you. Therefore, I'm withdrawing myself either emotionally, mentally, or even physically, as depending on what I need. Is. Then comes this thing finally to list out these one or two people, perhaps not everybody has that thing, thankfully, but by chance you have been very badly hurt by one or two people who are important to you or whatever it is. It may be present, it may be past. It may even be that, you know, my father always used to put me down when I was a child. He treated me miserably. Even though years and decades have gone past, maybe even my father is no more also, it doesn't matter. But if I have not forgiven him, my life is getting affected right now. So like I said, it's not a question of going there and telling him that I forgive you, but in my heart of hearts, I was vulnerable. I was a small child. I was under your control. You were supposed to love me and give me a good this thing. Yes, you did provide for me. You sent me to school, you did this, you gave me food, you gave everything. But the way you treated me emotionally, that hurt I carry even now. And to get over that hurt, I need to ensure that now at least I will not allow you to do this sort of thing. Once you can start getting into all these things, you also can question yourself, by not forgiving the person, how is my life getting affected? List it down. If you are really rational, you will realize that yes, every now and then I'm getting, for example, short-tempered with my child. Because I'm become that irritable type of person. My child doesn't deserve to be scolded just because somebody else is being nasty or was nasty to me, and I'm carrying that. I cannot trust people. I become very suspicious of people. Even when a friend comes and tries to get close to me or tries to do me some favors, I immediately start asking myself, why is she being so nice to me? Is there a vested interest? Is this person also going to cheat me? Because of this, I'm not going to spoil all my other aspects of life. Once you start doing that, then comes the question of how you can help others in that situation. That also in detail I've given in the book, that you can have a look at it if you want. I'll just quickly run over it. Create an awareness, whoever my counselee is, create an awareness in that person how deep the hurt is and how emotionally it has been. First, always check in this sort of situation if there is a medical angle to it, if some health checkup is required, if something else. See, people go into depression because of various medical things. A person, you know, with hypothyroidism can keep going more into depression than the person would have gone otherwise. A person who is hypertensive, you know, will have wide mood swings, he will not be able to control his temperature. So if his, you know, blood pressure is kept under control, then he automatically, his behavior, his control over his emotions, you know, improves. So anything on that medical side or something of that sort, you need to look into those things. Help the person to relive those painful this thing. As I told you, no, I don't want to talk about it. Create that awareness. The very fact that you are saying I don't want to talk about it means it still hurts you, that sort of thing. Help him also to understand from the other person's point of view, why did that person do it? Because I was a soft target. That person was nice to everybody else, but was nasty to me. So that's where I said, no, that how much was your contribution? You allowed that person to, you know, ride roughshod over you. The other people who are assertive or who could, you know, give it back to you, or very angry people or whatever it is, immediately this person backed out. But with you, he knew that I can take a chance, I can do whatever I want with you. Then help the person to understand what you would do now in future if this sort of situation comes to you. Balance it with the good things that happened to you in life. This is very important. We get obsessed with one or two people who have been bad to us, and we neglect all the people who have been good to us. Make a list of those people. Starting with family, let's say one family member has been bad to you, we inevitably forget that there are others who are good to me. Somebody who says that, you know, my mother-in-law, father-in-law, somebody has been very nasty to me. There are other people in my in-laws' family who have actually been very nice to me. I tend to keep away from them. I tend to neglect my relationship with them, that sort of thing. And once you do that, you can help your counselee or your friend to balance the good and bad that has happened. Otherwise, we tend to become bitter. See, I was cheated of my property. See, I lost out on that relationship. See, all this person was so nasty to me. We get so obsessed. We need to help the person to balance the thing. And then ask this question, how is it helping you to live in the past? Are you feeling good? If you're not feeling good, please help yourself. You owe it to yourself. Here I am as your friend, your counselor, whatever I am. I'm willing to help you. But you have to take the initiative and you have to, you know, work on that thing. And forgiveness is a tool which can help you to overall improve your quality of life. Finally, avoiding the shortcuts. As I said, people get into addictions just because, you know, I'm very badly hurt or something. So I will get addicted to something, I start drinking, I start smoking, I start whatever. It may be getting into wrong relationships or something of that sort. So avoid that sort of thing. In fact, if possible, once you find that your healing process is going on, see if you can link up with somebody. Unfortunately, in India, the concept of self-help support groups has not grown very well, except this Alcoholics Anonymous and a few. Most other, I myself, over the years, started a number of self-help support groups. None of them really lasted out for any sufficient thing. And I told them that you have to come together. See, if 5 of us or 10 of us have gone through the same experience or having the same pain, then we can sit and share in a closed environment, no outsider allowed. It is we who so we can freely share with each other. But if it is possible, since there aren't too many organized self-help support groups, even if you can find one or two people and say, okay, 2 of us or 3 of us have been in the same boat, come, let's share experiences and this and that, so that we keep reinforcing to each other. That is how it goes. Now, if you have questions, you can ask. If you want that booklet, Anis is sitting there quietly, you can take.
So in the case of suicide,
yeah,
the husband committed suicide and it was a marriage of 40 years.
Right.
And the husband has not left the suicide room.
Right.
How can the wife forgive and forget such a long relationship? Hasn't he cheated on her?
Very true, very true. See, let us say that I am the bereaved spouse, my husband, my whatever it is, 40 years. And I was complacent. I was thinking
in
that my
mother and daughter, the daughter commits suicide.
Well, either way. It could be any very close relationship, like a parent and child or a husband, wife or whatever it is. In these circumstances, I am left with a shock that this person suddenly committed suicide. The feeling that comes to me, the survivor, is that you have happily gone away and abandoned me. I was dependent on you in so many ways, sometimes financially, sometimes emotionally, or whatever it is.
Children also.
Children, whatever. So the responsibility of the children comes to me. Therefore, you have left me high and dry. So it's very natural to feel angry with that person and to feel that, you know, I have been cheated or let down by that person. The same steps can be gone through for a moment, forgetting that the person is dead. You can help that person if she is willing, if you find that. See, the initial time period of being angry, that's a grieving process that we talk about. Anger, blame, shame, all that. It takes time. But once that basic time has gone past, and the person is still carrying that hurt and is not able to overcome that loss and suicide and the anger that this person abandoned me or whatever it is, then you go through that grieving process the same way. And the grieving automatically leads to some level of forgiveness and then move on to these steps, it's possible.
No, but if people start committing, oh, your husband committed suicide, how will you forgive that, you know, thing and evil?
Yes. That's what I said. No, always remember, one is those who are important to me. One is those who are perpetually going to be making comments or something of that sort. So when you say people, I hardly know this neighbor who lives down the road. She has never risen to the occasion, never been nice to me, except we say hello and chat for 5 minutes. Suddenly she seems to be so interested in me. Ah, your husband committed suicide. What happened? This. Thank you. I'm comfortable. I don't want to discuss these matters with you. You can even be a little hurt and rude. You say, ah, I went to help her and see, she was so nasty to me. Let her say that. But at least you can get her back. This is not important. No? Learn to differentiate that. That is the aim. Yep.
You told me that you were telling that you have to be tolerant towards a person who is not to be tolerant towards a person who is hurt.
Yeah.
But when it comes to our own, say, you know, very loved, close and loved ones,
yeah,
do we have to be that assertive and drawing that line with them to be able to be necessary?
Yes. The closer the person is to you, the more important it is, because that person's capacity to hurt you is much more.
But do you think that will create a lot of divide within
it
the
will, family? It will. Initially, there will be a lot of turbulence. That person will even start blaming you and saying, you know, you are like this, you are like that, and all that sort of thing. But over a period of time, you will realize that life is long. You have to prepare, particularly if it's a close person.
Is it advisable to give a silent treatment?
The treatment that you give, you will automatically know once you have done the forgiveness. Okay, I have hurt you badly, I am very close, I am your father, uncle, brother, whatever, somebody very close to you, and I hurt you very badly. Once you have reconciled and you are at peace within yourself, you will automatically know whether to move out of the house and, you know, go away. Either you can tell me that, sorry, I can't live with you, I am going out. Or if you don't want to make a scene, you can say, I'll take up a job in Chennai or Delhi or something, you know, can't help it, you know, I had to take that job or this job is not there. So you use some reason and you go away. Or my office is in Electronic City, I'm finding it very difficult to commute, so I'll stay there. Whatever, if that is possible. If that is not possible, then as you said, it could be silent, being very silent, being very withdrawn from that person. talking something which is basic necessity. Yes, dinner is on the table, or I have kept the car key here, or something, whatever you need to communicate. But not go beyond. Even if I sit and, you know, crack some stupid joke, you will look at me like this, and then you will say, okay, dinner is ready. So the message is very clear to me that, sorry, you've been so nasty to me, I am not going to allow you to. That is one very important thing which has been drilled into us based on our Indian culture, and more so with women. Women are supposed to be only, you know, lord and master. You have to first father, then husband, then son. Yes, Sunita, I think you have this.
Booklets.
Huh?
And we don't tell about self-love, we tell them in
mantra.
They don't
care.
Yeah.
Yeah. No shortcuts. Yes. Attitude is different and bad habits is different. Bad habits is you cultivate the bad habit. So you cannot go for treatment and say, because my wife nagged me, I got it
wrong. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. That the moment you're passing the buck, you'll never improve. First you have to acknowledge and accept. Yeah. So we have 2 minutes. Anybody wants a booklet, please take it, because after that the default class is starting.
It's 20.
And Seema had some quick announcements to make, and faculty members are already sitting waiting outside. The default class has to start.
Right, on self-love. So please come to Manthan and you'll have some fantastic sessions by Ali. What else can I say? So all of you here and there as well, please come to Manthan on Saturday. You can come to stay the whole day, stay back the night, or you can choose to go at night. Whatever it is, we have sessions by Ali. We'll do a lot of introspection on self-love. So see you then again. Bye-bye.